Mary, blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb.
Breath of heaven, hold me together.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, heaven's love reaching down to save the world. lift the name of Jesus. He's the one who is worthy. Let's praise Jesus. He is worthy. Imagine Christmas without Jesus. It would be no Christmas at all, because Jesus came. That's why we can celebrate Christmas. So right now, with all the Christmas spirit, make a couple of compliments for people around you, and you may be seated. And this is a great reminder of what really happened on that night when Jesus came into this world. Welcome again to this celebration of Jesus. And I'm so glad you're here today. And I know that when we watch the video, when we hear the songs, we are reminded again how significant, how powerful really the story of Christmas is. And I'm so glad we get to celebrate Christmas. I want to make sure that you take advantage today of everything that's happening here. Take pictures with Santa. How many of you already did that? Took pictures with Santa? You know, Santa's really nice, and it's real Santa. We have connections, so make sure you take those pictures. And also, don't leave people out there by the nativity to hang out there in the cold, right? Go say hello and pet some animals and take pictures and hot cocoa. Everything's here for you today, so make sure you take advantage of that. This is our last in-person Sunday service of the year. So next Sunday, I invite you to tune in for at-home service with your family. Invite your friends and family and enjoy that. But this Friday at Christmas, for Christmas Eve, we're going to have another two services, family services, candlelight. Make sure you're here to celebrate that, and we're going to close our year together in celebration of Jesus. And also, don't forget, next year we're starting with a week of prayer and fasting, first week in January, starting January 3rd. We are starting a week of prayer and fasting. Make sure you're here every day at 6 p.m. and Wednesday at 7. Stay tuned in to our social media to be updated. But I'm planning next year. I know this year has not been easy, but tell me this. We're still here. We have hope. You're not hungry. You're all looking great. So let's look at life for what it really is. Life isn't easy, but because of Jesus, we are here and we can be hopeful. We can celebrate. And today, I wanted just to present a simple gospel message. I think it's very, very appropriate on Christmas to talk about what Christmas really means to us. And if you are a follower of Jesus, if you're a Christian and been Christian for a while, you need to be reminded what Christmas is all about, what gospel is all about. And if you are here for the first time, maybe you haven't heard the presentation of the gospel in this manner, I'm so glad you get to hear this today, because Christmas is good news. Gospel means good news. Why is it a good news? And I'll tell you all about it. But let me tell you, Christmas is the most wonderful time of the year. But Christmas is also the busiest time of the year. Anybody can relate? The gifts, right? The gifts. What do you buy to people who already have everything imaginable? What do you buy for them? I think virtual baskets really help us, right? Just hint, hint, put it in a basket just for a later day. Maybe somebody's going to notice it accidentally. So those are good tips. And of course, we're so blessed with that. But also, parties to attend, and if you're married, you know, you think, okay, who are we going to celebrate first? If your families both live here, your family, your spouse's family, how to figure out schedule. So make sure you, if you haven't done that, do it peacefully, okay? Remember, it's Christmas. Don't do any kind of thing that you're going to regret. And if you have kids, right, you have to go to school plays. If your kids are school age, you go to school plays, and the more you have, the more there are to go. So we have four children, and in advance, we ask our older kids to forgive us because we are not really attending those, but we try to be there for younger kids and, of course, you know, be there for them. But have you ever gone to a Christmas play that your child wasn't a part of in school? Anybody in here? Not very many. Some of you. Some of you are a teacher. We had some teachers in first service, and they're like, oh, I have, of course, you're a teacher. But let me tell you, if as a parent, when you go to those things, it's fun to watch the parents camera ready. They're going to roll it. They're going to be like excited for the child. Why? It makes a difference. If your child in a play, this is like the biggest moment of your life because you're connected. You know something's about to happen. And I cheer for those parents more sometimes than I cheer for those kids. The whole family and third cousins all come out for one child. That's exciting to see. And sometimes we look at Christmas story as though it's just a play. Happened somewhere there. Who cares? It's been a long time ago. Even as Christians, we get so used to Christmas story that it doesn't move us anymore. But let me tell you something. Christmas is not a play. It's a real story that happened to real people that has real consequences for us today. And it could really change our lives even today. But there is more than that. You have a role to play in the Christmas story. You have a part in a Christmas story that God has assigned to you specifically. As we read the Gospels, and today I want to read from the Gospel of Luke chapter 2 verse 10. Here is this conversation. When the angel appeared to the shepherds, he said this, and the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news, the gospel of great joy that will be for all the people, not just for the Jews. Remember, Jews were the chosen people, not just for the few talented and famous and rich, for you, for all people. You are all people, because this started from the kings from the east, and then it made its way to the shepherds in the Middle East. And I think even for us today in Midwest, we get to hear the story of Christmas. We are so blessed, and it's still changing lives. As we continue to read the Gospel of Luke in chapter 2, verse 11, here is what the angel also said to them. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. He didn't tell them, here is the message. You're just a messenger. The angel said, for unto you, the shepherds, the lowest of the low, he came to them and he said, this message is for unto you. So regardless of who you are today, of your past, of your achievements or lack thereof, this message is for you. And this word, a Savior, is born when Matthew, in his gospel, in one of the four gospels, he writes to us his account of Christmas story in chapter 1, verses 21 through 23. Here is his account of the events that took place. And he's writing to us about the conversation between an angel of the Lord and Joseph, the one who was engaged to be married to Mary, but he finds out she's pregnant and he loves her. He's a good man. So he wants to quietly release her and let her go. But angel of the Lord appears to him, and here is this conversation Matthew wrote for us. And she will have a son, says the angel, and you are to name him Jesus. But he didn't speak English. He says, Joshua. And you know what Joshua means? Yahweh saves. His name would be Savior, for he will save his people from their sins. All this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. And he's quoting Isaiah. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Imagine this. A young man about to be married, but he was waiting for this moment. The whole Israel, they were waiting, praying, singing songs. And all of a sudden, he hears from an angel, he is coming. Emmanuel, God with us, he's coming right into this city. What a joy. That's why Christmas is such a joyous celebration. People are just happy for Christmas. But people ask this question. If God is coming to us, Emmanuel, where was God all this time? Was he gone? Why do we need God now? And here is the thing. Every time something bad happens in the world, you know, first thing people are asking, where is God? If he's so good, if he's so caring, why all these horrible things are happening? Let me tell you why. God created people and he placed them in a paradise. But people thought they knew better and they chose their own way. They parted from God. They started choosing their own ways. Look at our own lives. If you ever find yourself in trouble, heartbroken, sinful, addicted, you know why? Because you say no to what God says and you choose your own way, but it doesn't stop God from saving you and me. He says the Messiah is coming. Messiah is coming not to save himself. A Savior is coming to save us. That's why Christmas is so significant. From the very moment people disobeyed God, evil and sin separated God from people. There was a big gap that could never fill, that never fill. So when you see visible presence of evil in people, in their actions, you know why it's happening? It's the presence of sin in their lives. Every evil thing in this world is rooted in sin. When we choose our own way, when we pursue our own pleasure and our own choices, we are finding trouble. That's why the prophet Isaiah delivered the word from God, is saying the Messiah is coming to fix what sin has broken, to restore what we gave up because of our own choices. The Messiah is coming because we feel it every day in this world. When you feel heartache, when you are hurting, when you experience greed, hate, pride, you see selfishness in other people, when you experience the effects of it, everything of that nature is rooted in sin. But why should we go far? How about our own brokenness? When you try to do what is right, but instead you said what felt natural at the moment, you let them have it, right? And then you realize, why did I just do that? It just came naturally to you because you and I are sinners and we need a Savior. We need someone from the outside to save us. Because when we lie still, when we make ourselves look better than we truly are, you know what we're trying to do? We're trying to cover up. But we need a Savior, not a partner. Someone unlike me. Someone unlike you. If you are sitting with somebody in a prison cell, condemned for the same thing you're there for, that person cannot be your Savior because they have their own troubles in life. So we need a Savior from the outside. We need someone who can come and rescue us. We need a Savior, one who is not subjected to the same weaknesses, who does not suffer from their own sins and consequences. We don't need a partner to save us. We need a Savior, and His name is Jesus. That's why Christmas is so significant. It's God coming into our world and reaching out to save us. We didn't deserve it. We didn't ask for it, but God loved us so much. We need a Savior who is stronger than us, who has authority and ability to set us free, who is free indeed. And Jesus said, if you will know me and you know my truth, you will be free indeed. This freedom we're talking about, it's not to do evil unpunished, but to do good because you're rooted in Christ. When you're choosing what is right, in spite that you are not right, but the one who lives in you by the Holy Spirit produces the results of your life and they start a change. You know, walking with Jesus is not an event, it's a journey. That's why, as Connect Church, we're so passionate. We exist to connect you with God who loves you, who has a purpose for your life, and we know that we are on a journey. No one here is perfect, only Jesus is. But when we walk on this spiritual journey, we need one another so we can help, we can stand together and be stronger. We need a Savior, one who is eternal. How many of you know this life is temporary? Statistically, you know, 100 people out of 100 will eventually die. Just simple truth, right? So we need a Savior who said, I will not only be here with you in this life, I'll see you in the next life. That's kind of Savior we have. He said, I'm going to leave you here, but I'm going to and prepare your place with my Heavenly Father. And when you get there, I'm going to welcome you there. That's kind of Savior we need. So our Savior is God, Jesus Christ, who came and He was incarnate in flesh like ours to rescue us and to deliver us. because of Christmas, we have a Savior. Jesus came to change your story. If you remove Jesus from Christmas, it's not Christmas at all. Jesus came to save us. What do you want your life story to be? If you were to write your own life story, and you know, this is how I know I'm getting up there in years when I tell young people, write your own obituary. And what do you want it to sound, look like? And then live towards it, right? How do you want people to remember you? Whether we realize it or not, we write our own life story daily. The way we live our lives, we write our life story. Believe me, Jesus did not come to bring us a religion. He did not come to take us away from our lives and put us in church. No, He came to change the way we live in everyday life. But here is the thing, when we get busy to write our own life story, we forget the author of life, Jesus Himself. Because from the cover to cover of the Bible, He left us. He talks to His people. He says, I want to know you personally. I don't need your dues on Sundays. I need to know you personally. You need me in your life daily. That's the message of Christmas. Jesus came to be with us. Emmanuel, God is with us because God who created us, He has a plan for your life. Do you believe that? If He has created you, if you have ever made anything, there is a purpose. Of course, when you cook, you feel like the purpose is very short-lived, right? Disappears so fast. That's why I think cooking, home cooking is less and less popular nowadays. You don't feel appreciated. You just invested so much time and it's gone. But you love seeing your family to experience joy and good food. I believe when God created you, He had great plans for your life. And He thrives. He enjoys to see you fulfill your purpose. Don't push Him away. That's what religion does. God, I'm going to become better and then I'll come to you and I'll show you how good I am. That's not the gospel. The gospel, God wants to be in your life every day. Jesus is a king. He's not a politician who's constantly checking his popularity polls, see which way to go, what to say. Jesus is a king. You know how He decides things? He decrees. He says, you are my child. If I said so, you will get it. That's His kingdom. That's His kingdom. He's a king. He was born a king. Remember when the wise men came to Jerusalem, their question was, where is the newborn king? We saw His star. Remember, Jesus was crucified between two criminals. But what was the sign above His head? The King of the Jews. He died a king. But He said, my kingdom is not of this world. That's why as Christians, we don't seek popularity. We seek purpose. Why we've been called to follow Jesus. And when John, the apostle, was allowed to see the future, he says, I saw a rider on a white horse, and his name was the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's the kind of Jesus we serve. That's why Christmas is so significant. It has power to change your life. But Jesus is not king to rule your life. He says, I am the good shepherd. He's a shepherd king. Very unlikely combination. He says, I am the good shepherd who lays His life down for the sheep. But He's the king because He has authority and power. But in His kingdom, everything that's available has to go through the channels that He installed. You cannot come in God's kingdom and claim your own will, because when we do, we automatically exclude ourselves from the will and the kingdom of God. In Romans 6:23, the Bible clearly says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. But it doesn't stop there. Through Christ Jesus our Lord. The only way you and I can have our sins forgiven is because of Jesus. Because you and I deserve death. You know why? Because we are sinful people. And if you will be honest with yourself, you know you're sinful. You are prideful. You are selfish. You thought bad thoughts about other people. You wish them, you know, sleep on a hot pillow, like my daughter says. You wish something, somebody not as good as for yourself. You are a sinful person. And the Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And it's only possible through Christ Jesus. But because Jesus is a different kind of king, he offers everything for free, but he says, the only one way you can receive what I have to offer is by faith. Listen to me. If you grew up in church that taught you that being in heaven means believing in Jesus and doing good, and if you do enough good, then maybe God will receive you in heaven. That's not the gospel you have heard. Every religion in the world teaches you to be good. Did you know that Ten Commandments are pretty much identical in every religion in the world? So what's different about the gospel? The every religion of the world says do, and Jesus said it is done for you. You don't have to do. So why do we follow Jesus? Because he loved us, and now we love him, and we are so moved by him. He indwells us with the Holy Spirit, and he makes us able to produce the fruit of righteousness in our lives. That's the true gospel. If you think you can achieve heaven by yourself, you're not following Jesus. You're following your own religion, and you will not be in heaven. That's why Jesus came. Here is Jesus' version of the gospel. In John 3:16, Jesus said this, "For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." Have you noticed? Jesus didn't say, everyone who does good, who believes. You can never afford salvation because we are broke. We are sinners. And Jesus paid it all. That's why the message of gospel is the message of love. Before you ever cry out to God, God has a solution for you. God says, through my Son, Jesus, you are saved. And you can receive it by faith. That's the message of Christmas. If you claim it by faith, you don't have to do anything. Jesus will tell you, you are his son, you are his daughter. And as such, you give your kids gifts that they don't never deserve or can ever afford. That's what our Heavenly Father does. He gives you salvation. He gives me salvation, not because of what we have done, but because of our position. We are children of the King of Kings. He can afford things we can't. But being his children, we live a life that honors our King. We live a life empowered by his Spirit and his authority. So we can overcome the enemy because Jesus has overcome the enemy. Maybe you've heard this before, but you say, so what do I do? What's the next step? So today I want to give you 4 steps how to receive God's gift of Jesus. It's a gift of Jesus. How to receive it? Number one, realize God was not first in your life and ask him to forgive your sins. Neglecting God is a great sin. Your creator who has a plan for your life. You can't choose your own life or your own plan. God has a plan for your life. God doesn't want to take you out of your life, but he wants to give you perimeters. He wants to give you guidance. But more than anything, he wants you to trust your life to him. Make him the Lord of your life. That's Jesus said, love God with all of your heart, with all of your mind. He should be first and your first priority in your life. Ask him to forgive your sins. Number two, believe that Jesus died to pay the wages of your sin. You can never pay for your sins. You can never be good enough to be in heaven. But you know what happened to Jesus? The Bible is so clear about this. Jesus rose again. You know why? Because sin had no authority over him. He was sinless. But once he paid for our sin, death had no authority over him. He rose again. And now he can intercede on our behalf saying, I pay for this one and for that one and for that one. They place their trust in me and for that one. That's what the gospel is all about. And it's not about ourselves. It's about what Jesus did for us. Number three, accept God's free gift of salvation by faith. Trust your life to God. Don't think you can make it on your own. No one will. We need Jesus in our life. So accept Number four, invite Jesus to come into your life and ask Him to be the Lord of your life. Asking Jesus into your life is not an addition to your life. He must be the Lord of your life. That means every day you are guided by His principle, by His authority. You gain peace in your heart, knowing that He's in charge, that He guides you. That's what life with Jesus looks like. You put yourself down, you allow Jesus to reign in your life, to rule you. Would you please bow your heads with me right now? I don't want to lead you in this simple, simple prayer. And I'm asking you today, if the Holy Spirit is calling you right now and saying it's you who needs Jesus, it doesn't matter how long you've been coming to church or this is your first time here in the gospel presentation, I want you to respond. That's why Jesus is came. Don't reject the gift of God today. Receive it with your heart. So church, help me to pray this prayer. And I'm asking to everyone stay put in your place. Don't move. Let's pray this prayer together. And I know God, being faithful and true, He will grant salvation to those who ask in Him today, because that's His promise. Heavenly Father, thank You so much for Jesus. Thank You so much for coming just for me, for sending Jesus to die on my behalf. And I thank You for salvation. I receive by faith, and I claim Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my sins. I leave my past behind, and I want to live as a child of God. I receive it by faith, and I'm a new creation because of what Jesus did for me. I thank You, and I worship You, and it's in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please stand with me, and let's celebrate this prayer. Let's celebrate for just a moment. Because this prayer does not have power in itself. But God, who promised to deliver us, He has power. And for those of you who just prayed this prayer, thank you, Ashley. Those of you who prayed this prayer, we have a gift for you. Whether you pray for the first time today or you rededicate in your life to Jesus, we have this special book for you. It's called New Believer's Bible with Commentaries, and a book, What It Means to Follow Jesus. Very simple presentation by Chris Hodges. We want to equip you, because following Jesus is not an event. It's not a Sunday thing. It's a journey of faith. And every one of us is on this journey who made their decision to follow Jesus. So claim one of your books today. Go to Welcome Center, and one of our team will talk to you and tell you and celebrate with you. Because the first thing the shepherds heard from the Lord, they said, go and tell. When Jesus left, He told His disciples, go and tell. Jesus did not come to establish a religion. He came to create a family. And we need one another in His family. So as you celebrate today, we want to celebrate with you. I love you, church. Merry Christmas. But I want to end this service in worship. He deserves it. Let's worship our King.
He has come for us, this Jesus.
Church was given free.